will see few questions and answers, few questions which is asked by many of our devotees yesterday. And then after answering the questions, if time permits, we'll see. Respected Swamiji, why did Krishna choose a battlefield to deliver the great knowledge of Gita? Because planet Earth is battlefield. Please be very clear. In last 2000 years of recorded history, we have fought 5000 wars. In last 2000 years of recorded history, we have fought 5000 wars. We are not doing anything except doing wars. Except fighting, we are not doing anything. The gap between one war and the other war cannot be called as peace, because that gap is preparation time for the other war. That's all. You do only two things. Either you fight or prepare for the next fight. You know, morning when you fight and go away to office, by evening the other arguments will be ready. You are preparing for the next fight. So planet Earth is war field. That is the reason planet Earth is a battlefield. That is the reason Krishna chose battlefield to deliver his message. There are three kinds of situation on the planet Earth. One is win-win. Another one is win and lose. Third is lose-lose. Win-win situation is master and disciple. Master also wins the disciple. Disciple also wins enlightenment. Both of them achieve something. Nobody loses. Neither master loses by giving enlightenment. By giving, he only enjoys. Nor the disciple loses anything. He just gets the enlightenment. This is win-win situation. Next, win and lose. All our business is win and lose situation. Somebody wins, the other person loses. The third kind of situations, worst situations, lose and lose. Both the person loses. Battlefield is the lose and lose situation. Both the parties lose. Even if you say that so-called winning is not winning, both the parties lose. Krishna delivers the Gita in the battlefield because he gives solution for the worst situations. Even the worst situations of the life, the lose-lose situations are also addressed by Gita. That is why he chose battlefield to deliver the knowledge. I think that is the right place to deliver the spiritual message. Because if something cannot be used in worst situation, you cannot take that as ultimate message. If something can be used in the worst situation, then you can take, you can be sure it is the ultimate message. You can use that message wherever you want. It's like a master key. If it opens the worst key, naturally it will open all the other keys. So Krishna gives the life solutions for the worst situations. That is why he chose the battlefield to deliver his message, to deliver the message of Gita. Respected Swamiji, after all, Arjuna wanted ahimsa, non-violence, but Krishna inspired him to be violent. Why would an enlightened person do that? Now please understand, first understand the word non-violence. the moment you say the I and mine, you are violent. Please be very clear. Only a person who has lost his I and mine can be non-violent. The moment you say this is mine and that is somebody else's, you already created violence. Naturally, you will be violent. The moment you have the idea, you create the idea, I and mine, you will be violent. You already divided. The moment you divide, you will be violent. Only a person who has lost the I and mine will be non-violent. Here, Arjuna is not non-violent. Be very clear. He says he doesn't want to fight because he feels all of them are his relatives. Not because of ahimsa, because he feels they are his relatives. Because of I and mine, he doesn't want to fight. Not because of non-violence. Please understand. Again and again he says, Swajanam, Swajanam, Swajanam. In this one chapter, three places he says, Swajanam. 28th sloka. Then again 31st. And again 37th. In three slokas, he says, Swajanam, Swajanam. Let me give you the slokas. Wherever he says Swajanam. Drishtvemam Swajanam Krishna Yuyutsam Samubastitam. The 28th sloka he says, Swajanam, my people. Swajanam means my people. And then again, the 31st. Nimitta nichapashyami viparidani keshava nasasreyo nupashyami hatva swajanam ahave. Again Swajanam. The third, Tasman narga vayam andum dartha rashtran svabandavan svajanam hi kadam hatva sukhi nasyama matavaha. Again and again, he is worried just because they are his relatives. When your I is involved, it can never be ahimsa. Please be very clear. When the war started, it started for dharma. But slowly he forgot the dharma. Instead of dharma, he started thinking, I am doing this war for my pleasure. Why should I do? I am doing this war for my pleasure itself is wrong. This war is not started for Arjuna's pleasure. It started for dharma's sake. Because the dharma was not established, because the Duryodhana did not give the share, which is their due, which is Pandava's due, for dharma's sake the war started. But when the goal has changed, no, just for my pleasure I am doing the war, then all the confusion entered. As long as the dharma is goal, you will not have confusion. Here the confusion entered because the goal has changed. The goal has changed. Please be very clear, Arjuna is not refusing to fight because of non-violence. He is refusing to fight because of his attachment. One more thing you should understand. Your I and mine is invested on all your relatives. When your relatives die, you feel something is taken away from you. One thing important, not only your relatives, even if your enemy dies, you will feel the emptiness. You will feel something is missing. Why do you think these politicians, when both of them are alive, they will fight continuously? When one person is dead, the other person will give statements, condolence. The moment opposition leader dies, this guy gives condolence statements. And he really feels, because he is missing somebody in his life. You have invested your ego even on your enemy. Even if your enemy dies, you will feel something is missing. So here, he doesn't want to fight just because of his ego, just because of his fear, not because of non-violence. Please be very clear. Non-violence is different. Fear is different. Here he asks Krishna, Krishna, let me go away to forest. If Krishna says, yes, you go. After going to the forest, next day you will start hunting. Next day you will start hunting. You think he is non-violent. Next day he will start hunting. He will be violent because animals are not his relative. Here he is not ready to kill just because he feels attached. Relative. Swajanam. Not once or twice, three times. In Sanskrit grammar, if you say, if you repeat any word three times, they say it is there from your deep consciousness. The feeling comes out of your unconsciousness. Any word, if it is repeated three times, the concept is from your unconsciousness. So here he says, in one chapter, three times, swajanam, swajanam, swajanam. Then how can you say he is not fighting because of non-violence? No. It is pure attachment. The ideal of dharma is drop. He dropped or he forgot the ideal of dharma. What for he started the war. That idea is forgotten. That is why he says, I don't want to fight. And Krishna wants him to understand the whole truth. Krishna wants him to understand the whole truth. If Arjuna says, I will not fight because of ahimsa, Krishna will be the first person to encourage. Yes, don't worry. Go and rest. Go and rest. Krishna has sent his own brother Balarama. You should know the deep stories of Mahabharata. His own brother Balarama. Balarama comes and asks Krishna, Krishna, I don't want to fight. I feel like going for Tirtha Yatra. I want to do spiritual practice. Krishna says, please go. He blesses and sends the Balarama. Balarama did not appear in the Mahabharata war. He was there at the time, but he did not appear in Mahabharata war. Balarama did out of real ahimsa. He felt the compassion, went and asked Krishna. Krishna gave permission and blessing. But this is not out of compassion. This is out of fear. That is why Krishna says, no, fight. Please be very clear. The end cannot justify the means. The decision cannot justify the attitude. Not only the decision, attitude also has to be clear. Not only the decision, attitude also has to be clear. Here, Arjuna and Balarama both made the same decision, but different attitudes. So Arjuna is not matured. Arjuna is not taking the decision out of right attitude. So here, all Krishna is teaching is only one thing, or all Krishna's work. Krishna is doing only one thing, teaching right attitude to Arjuna. Right attitude to Arjuna. So please be very clear, Arjuna is not non-violent. Arjuna is not ahimsavadi. So don't be worried about Arjuna. Dear Swamiji, how could an enlightened master like Krishna have so many thousands of girlfriends? Can you please explain about Rasa Leela? Now starts the big problem. I tell you, this question goes, how could an enlightened master like Krishna have so many thousands of girlfriends? Can you please explain about Rasa Leela? Only an enlightened person like Krishna can manage so many thousands of girlfriends. Just try second and third, then you will understand. If you have only one woman in your life, enlightenment is luxury. If you have two women in your life, enlightenment is option. If you have three women in your life, enlightenment is compulsory. Basic need. Without that you cannot survive. Please be very clear. Here we need to understand few things. If you read Bhagavatam, the whole Rasa Leela happened before the Krishna left Vrindavan. When he was 10, he left the Vrindavan. Please understand, before he left the Vrindavan, Rasa Leela happened. He left Vrindavan when he was 10. Then how can you give any wrong meaning to the whole Rasa Leela? Whole thing is just child play. Somehow, we were not able to understand the whole Rasa Leela scene. We never studied Bhagavata deeply. Just a superficial hearsay. And we start criticizing. We start comparing. We start calling. We start naming things. Please be very clear. Rasa Leela is nothing to do with physical relationship. It's a pure Jivatma, individual souls celebrating the Paramatman, the super conscious energy. They were singing and dancing and celebrating the existence. They felt the blessing of Krishna's presence. And I tell you, why these so-called philosophers go on criticizing Rasa Leela? Because they are jealous. The truth is, they are jealous. The jealousy, you see, you don't condemn anybody unless you are jealous of that person. This is a basic rule. This is a basic thumb rule. When you condemn anybody, just look into yourself. Directly or indirectly, you are jealous of that person. When you can't justify your jealousy, you straight away start condemning. When you are not able to digest the jealous, you straight away start condemning. Few things. Even when divine descends on the planet Earth, these guys don't understand what the divine does. Let me tell you a small story. A young advertising agent. He goes to Seattle to eat, to have his lunch. In restaurant, he somehow finds Bill Gates. Bill Gates is sitting in one corner, he is eating. He went straight near to Bill Gates and said, "Sir, can you do a small favor for me? It will be really great. I will be eternally grateful to you if you do this small favor. I know you help so many people. You do so much of charity. Just do one small favor for me." Bill Gates asked, "What do you want?" "I will be sitting with my friends and talking. When you crash the table, just call my name and say, 'How are you?' Just inquire. Just call my name and say, 'How are you? How you are doing?' That's enough. this will change my image and naturally I'll encash on this whole image. Please do me this one favor. He gets that, all right, after all I'm doing so many things for so many people, small thing I can afford. He said, all right, I'll do. But somehow he forgets, Bill Gates forgets and goes to the room. After half an hour, suddenly he remembers. And he feels obliged. And he comes with all his compassion. This guy is sitting and talking, eating, he's waiting. Bill Gates comes and says, hi, how are you? What are you doing? This guy turns, Bill, I told you, I'm eating. Why are you disturbing me? I told you so many times, don't disturb when I'm eating. Why are you disturbing me? Same thing. When divine descends and plays with you, you criticize. Just how this young guy does, just what he did to Bill Gates, the same thing you do when you criticize Rasalila. When you criticize Rasalila, when you misunderstand Rasalila, you do this same thing. Understand this one story, you will understand Rasalila. I am not sure when Krishna delivered the message of Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, maybe a few thousand years ago. Do you think there is any relevance of Gita today? Gita is the only book which has got relevance. I can say Gita is the only book which says to live, which is life affirmative, which is not against the life. Any other book, any other spiritual literature makes your life into two parts, spiritual and materialistic. Gita is the one and only book which teaches you how to live. It is the only book which teaches you the quantum spirituality. Which teaches you the quantum spirituality. How to move in the material life and spiritual life both at a time. You always had a big problem. Many people come and ask me, Swamiji, should I choose spiritual life or material life? Should I choose this life or this life? Material life is horizontal, spiritual life is vertical line. Should I choose this line or that line? Please be very clear. You can travel in this line, in that line, same time, at a time. You can just explore in all the directions. Krishna is the one and only master. Gita is the one and only book which teaches you. You can travel in the horizontal line and vertical line at the same time. You don't need to choose between horizontal line and vertical line. You can just explore. There is no need to choose. A small story. One guy from America goes to London. He's traveling in train with an old English lady and gentleman. Old gentleman and old lady, couple. He's traveling with them. That old lady had a small pet dog. Suddenly the pet felt a little uneasy and jumped on this guy and pissed. Showered the teertha. This guy felt really disturbed. This lady, instead of apologizing, she just started patting the pet. Oh, I don't know what happened to you. I think you are not feeling well. Anyway, he kept quiet, new place. Why to go unnecessarily for fighting? After half an hour, again this dog jumped on him and vomited. Again this lady instead of apologizing, she started telling, I should give you some medicine, I think you are not eating well, please digest, what happened to you, what you are doing. This fellow somehow, he kept quiet. Again after half an hour, the dog jumped on him, now you know what it would have done. Now it is too much. This young guy simply stood, took the pet and threw out of the window. He just threw out of the window. Till this time, the old man was keeping quiet, gentleman. Now he stood up and said, you fools, you drive in the wrong side, you measure with wrong scales, now you threw the wrong bitch out of the window. You threw the wrong person out of the window. When you choose, you always choose the wrong person. Please be very clear. Whenever you choose, you always choose the wrong thing. All choices are wrong choices. If you choose the spiritual life, if you choose the spiritual life, you always feel you are missing the materialistic life. If you choose the material life, you always feel you are missing the spiritual life. Krishna is the only master. Gita is the only book which teaches you the quantum spirituality. You don't need to choose between spiritual life and material life. You can explode in both the directions. He is the first master who made spirituality as a practical living science. Till Krishna happened on the planet Earth, spirituality is only for those few who want to go and sit in the forest, think about the world. And only after Krishna, he brings a new light. He is a milestone. Krishna is a big breakthrough in the spiritual field. He is the person who introduces quantum spirituality. How a quantum is a big breakthrough in the physics field, same way, he introduces quantum spirituality. You can move in the horizontal line, means the material life, and in the vertical line, spiritual life, at the same time, in the same space. There is no need to choose. So Krishna and the Gita is the only relevant book to be read in this modern day. Oh God, it's a nice question. Did Sanjaya really have the telepathic powers, or you are just telling stories? Did Sanjaya really had telepathic powers, or you are telling stories? Now I should tell you something. First thing, understand the whole thing, whether it is Ramayana or Mahabharata, don't think it is just a story. No. It is history. There are some places where you are not able to understand the incidents intellectually, where we don't know, we are not able to realize, or we are not able to relate. Science is yet to catch with our spirituality. Please be very clear. Science is yet to catch with our spirituality. Just because you are not able to understand with your logical mind, don't think it's a story. No, it's a history. In America, I saw a website that whether you believe it or not, if you want, you can see the website. There are 2-3 websites. Whether you believe it or not is one website. And mysteries. All these strange things, they are recorded in the website. There's a man called Dead CEO in America only. He fell from second floor and had injury in his head. After that accident, suddenly he started seeing whatever he wants, wherever it is happening. Simply he started seeing. Not only he started seeing, his eyes are able to record the incident. Please understand, he's still alive. You can see this website. You will get the data, clear data, much more clear way. And he says, not only he's able to see, they are able to record. His eyes are able to record the incidents which he wants to see. Even thousands of miles away, he is able to just see what's happening. And he is just able to record and tell you what is happening there. And now in the modern day, so many thousands of researches are done in the psychic field. After that, in the last 10 years, after so many thousands of researches in the psychic field, there's a clear proof we do have extraordinary powers, no doubt about it. There was another one, lady in Scandinavia. She also had head injury and she started hearing continuously some radio program. From near radio station, she started hearing all the radio programs without any radio. And the big difficulty is she's not able to switch it off. Non-stop program is going on. They have to do operation finally to cure her. And apart from all these things, let me tell you a story from my own life. From my life. I usually avoid speaking about my personal experiences. But let me tell you for this one thing. When I was in my native place, Arunachala, I had an opportunity to see the great yogi called Narayanan Tata. His name is Narayanan Tata, grandfather. Tata means grandfather. His name is Narayanan Tata. Very elderly gentleman, around 70. He lived near a small temple. He used to predict and tell things. If somebody has lost some property, they will go to him and he will visualize or he will meditate and tell you where it is lost. And please be very clear, one thing, even I was surprised, regularly police people used to come to him. He is the advisor for local police station. And just by his advice, the local police station is built separate Devi temple. Just because he advised local police station, inside their police station, they built a separate temple. Still now, if you go to Arunachala, the local police station, inside police station, there is a Devi temple. You will see his photograph there. I had opportunity to live around him more than 4 or 5 years. I was a small boy. I used to go and sit with him. Somehow he also liked me very much. So he will make me sit with him. I have seen with my own eyes, somebody came to him and said they have lost some property. Some thief came and took away their properties. He just got an ordinary mirror. He took just an ordinary mirror, something like a black thing. Anjanam, they say Anjanam. What do you tell in English? Just the Anjanam, that black thing. He applied on that mirror. And he took the hand and did some meditation, chanted few words. Suddenly, the mirror started behaving like a TV. I tell you, I saw from my own eyes. With my own eyes, I have seen. It clearly showed how the whole thing happened. The thief coming, and just like a video camera. If you have captured the video camera, how it will show? Much more clearly it shows how thief entered the house and how he packed the things and how he left the whole face. And he can even do the pass and fast forward, rewinding everything. He just hit the pass and we could see the face clearly. The whole scene he showed. And then he told, he is in that village, go and catch. These people went and simply caught him, got the property back. I have seen with my own eyes, not once or twice, at least I can say 100 times I have seen this happening with him. At least 100 times. Difficult to believe for any logical person, very difficult to believe. But whether you believe it or not, truth is truth. Sometimes truth is truth. I have seen personally he doing. So clearly he will show. And he is a regular advisor for local police station. Any big problem, the local police officers will be at his feet. And he will tell the thing, everything will be clear. And he never failed. At least, as far as I know, he never failed. Clearly he will show. Not only he will see, you can also see. Even the other persons can see. So be very clear, there is something called supernatural powers. Only thing, we lost the key of how to achieving it. Because of the Western education system, the cultural invasion, we lost the keys in India. The meditation, the master key is lost. That is why it is difficult for us to believe that Sanjaya had this telepathy power. But I tell you, if you do a little bit of meditation, if you can go a little inside you, you will see, you will experience yourself. Let me ask one question. Actually, somebody asked me in a meditation program, Swamiji, when I am in party, when I am in some program, suddenly I will remember somebody's name. Suddenly I will remember some old friend's name. And after 5 minutes I will see you will be there. And the house and doorbell rings. Suddenly I will remember some old friend whom I have not seen for 5-6 years. When I open the door, he will be there. When a telephone rings, suddenly I remember somebody's name. When I take the phone, he is there on the other side. How this happens to me? Many times this has happened to me. How this happens? Why it is happening to me? I ask them, how many of you at least once had this experience in your life? In that group, more than 80% raised their hand. Let us see here. How many of you had this kind of experience at least once in your life? More than 80%. Again, if it happens in one person's life, some one time, you can say it's coincidence. You can just brush it aside in the name of coincidence. If it is happening in so many persons of life, in so many lives, how can you say it is coincidence? It is something more than coincidence. You can't just brush it aside in the name of coincidence. So be very clear, there is something called extraordinary powers. All you need to do is, you should know the science of how to awaken that power. With the right meditation, the power can be awakened. It can be used. Just because we don't have the key, you can't say the power itself doesn't exist. So please be very clear, Sanjaya really had the telepathic powers to hear and see things. How do we know what type of being we are? Intellectual, emotional, or being? During our life, do we have stages of each three characteristics? How do we know what type of being we are? Intellectual, emotional, or being? The moment you ask this question, be very clear, you are intellectual. Whomsoever is having this question, they are intellectual. The emotional people will never have the question. Being level people will not even have this doubt. So if you have the question, be very clear, you are intellectual. And during our life, we do have stages of each three characteristics. Before you are married, I can say you are intellectual. These young boys, college kids, especially Indian college kids, when they are brought by their parents to me, usually they will not bow down or they will not do namaskar. They think that it is very traditional. Why should we bow down to somebody? And why should we respect somebody? The ego. Ego doesn't allow you to bow down to somebody. They will not bow down, and they will, when the parents bow down, they will just stand and look at me, stare at me. They will just give a look. Of course, I don't want people to bow down, and what is there? It is after all, the respect is not by physical way of expression, not by just bowing down or falling at the feet. It is a mind. But I always think in my mind, fellow, let you get married, then. Just after 2 years, when he comes to meet me, you will see he will fall flat. Because of 1 year complete training. In 1 year, complete training will be done. And nothing more is necessary. The same guy, and he becomes so obedient, so polite, and complete training will be done. You don't need nothing. You don't need anything. You don't need any other training. Maybe before marriage, you are intellectual. Then slowly, slowly, you grow and reach other levels. Somebody has written, I am not able to read some question. It starts with Pujya Swamiji. Can I? If you are here, you can come and read it out. I'll answer. Because I am not able to read. One thing I am sure, it is English, that's all. I am not able to read. Let me tell you a story. It's reading and writing problem. There was an advertisement in the newspaper. We want a salesperson who knows how to read and write French. The manager received application which says, I can write but I can't read. The manager was curious. How can somebody write French and don't know how to read? He said, all right, let me see this guy. He called him for interview. This guy came for interview. And he said, please start writing. He started writing. Manager took the paper and said, what have you written? Please read. He said, I told you earlier. I can't read. I know only how to write. I can't read. I think this question is also like that. You can only read, you can't. You can only write, you can't. Read. I am not able to read. About the depression of success. What if you are under 40 and experience several depressions without success? Is there hope? Is there hope? Please be very clear that what you experience is not depression. It is just failure. Yesterday I told very clearly, depression of success comes only for mature beings. It is a gift from divine. It is a luxury in the life. I tell you, depression of success is the ultimate luxury. All cannot afford it. To have the depression of success, you need two things. All your outer needs should be fulfilled, and you must be intelligent. All your outer needs should be fulfilled. Second important thing, you need to be intelligent. Only when you have both, all the outer things, all the outwardly comforts, and intelligence to look beyond, you will have the depression of success. If you are depressed because of failure, it cannot be called as failure. It cannot be called as depression. It is just failure. If you are depressed without success, please be very clear. It is failure. It is not success. Listen to the Gita and learn how to work. If Krishna is the Jagat Guru, then why he did not help the world? He was only with Pandavas and Gauravas. What about the rest of the world? Can I know who asked this question? I think the person is not here. All right. Again and again, Krishna happens on the planet Earth, but nowadays he is not bringing the peacock feather. Krishna is the only master who assured, again and again I'll be here. Paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya sadushkritam dharma samstavanartaya sambhavami yuke yuke. Again and again I will come down. Paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya sadushkritam dharma samstavanartaya sambhavami yuge yuke. Again and again I will come down. And he always fulfills his promises. Be very clear. You need little openness to experience him. That's all. Never think he is not here. People go and ask Ramakrishna. There was a group of devotees who were sitting in front of Ramakrishna and they were talking. Oh, we were not there in the Chaitanya's period. We would have seen Chaitanya, we would have experienced the divine love, the great love. We missed Chaitanya. Ramakrishna says, there were some fools who were sitting in front of Chaitanya and talking. We missed Krishna. We were not seen Krishna. The same people only come back and sit in front of Ramakrishna and say, oh, we missed Chaitanya. Again, the same people will come and sit in front of Ramana Maharishi and they'll tell, we missed Ramakrishna. Again, you are sitting here and saying, we missed Krishna. Understand, all you need is just a little bit of openness. All you need is little sensitivity. If you have, you can listen to Krishna's flute here and now. If you miss it, you are missing it. So all we need to understand, all we need to do is to have little more sensitivity. Never think Krishna is not fulfilling his promise. He is fulfilling. Again and again and again, he comes down. He comes down and fulfills his promise. again and again he fulfills his promise. All you need to do is just have little more sensitivity and openness. You can experience him wherever you are. There's one more question. When you said yesterday, you are repeating, do you mean you are Krishna? Many proclaim they are God. Do you also proclaim the same thing? No, are you also in the same business? Nice question. May I know who asked this question? All right. Here he is asking, many proclaim they are God. Do you also proclaim you are God? I am not here to proclaim I am God. I am here to proclaim you are God. Please be very clear. I am not here to proclaim I am God. I am here to proclaim you are God. When Krishna says, I am God, when Krishna says, he is divine, when Krishna proves he is divine, he is preparing you, he is creating a situation in which you can receive his message and realize you are also divine. Please be very clear. When Krishna says, I am God, he is preparing you so that you can receive his message and experience you are God. Experience you are divine. That is why again and again Krishna has to prove, has to express his divinity. So be very clear, I am not here to proclaim I am God, I am here to proclaim you are God. I am not here to prove I am God, I am here to prove you are God. So, just have the experience of the divinity in you. Just experience you are God, that is enough. Nothing else is necessary. You don't need to accept I am God, or you don't even need to believe I am God. You don't even need to bother whether I am God or not. Just believe you are God. Just understand you are God, just experience you are God, that is enough. Nothing else is necessary. Thank you. Is it possible to be detached without being indifferent? How do we keep our hearts open along the spiritual path? Please be very clear. Only a man whose hearts are open can be detached. If you are indifferent, you will only be dull. You will not be detached. Only a man who can shower his being, who can shower himself completely, can detach himself completely. Be very clear. You never shower yourself on anybody because you are afraid that you may not be able to detach. The power to share and the power to detach is one and the same. If you can't share yourself intensely, you can't detach yourself. Person who struggles, he is half of in everything. He can neither attach nor detach. The person who can attach really with anybody, can attach himself, he can detach also. Is it normal to speak less and seek out silence as sadhana progresses? There's a beautiful Zen saying. When I was not meditating, tree is tree, mountain is mountain. And I started meditating. Tree is not tree, mountain is not mountain. When I finished my meditation, when I became enlightened, again tree is tree, mountain is mountain. Before the sadhana, you will speak a lot. After enlightenment, you may speak a lot. But at the time of sadhana, it is usual people tend to become silent. Here is a question. Swamiji, please be very clear. Oh, that is the instruction I got. First he gives the instruction. Please be very clear. Is Krishna and Christ the same? Both were born in a confided place. Krishna was born in Mathura. Christ in a place called Mathuriya. And both were shepherds and so on. If so, please explain. An historical controversy. I do not know the history because I am not a historian. I can say one thing. Spiritually, they are one and the same. I can say according to spirituality. I can't say historically. Because I don't know anything about history. Surely, I can't make any controversial statement about which I am not sure. I can say one thing, surely in the conscious level, they are one and the same. There are stories which says the whole Christ idea itself is from Bhagavatam. It travels and then the whole theory is developed or built or created and all these things. Of course, we don't know the truth behind this. Stories. Now there is a latest beautiful book, Da Vinci Code. Many of you read that book. Very controversial. But he is very solid. He is clear about what he is speaking. So we are not able to say complete no to him. I read that book. To tell you honestly, I am not able to say complete no to him. Because there are so many things which he says make sense. And there are so many research books which says that after the crucifixion, life of Christ, and between the 7 and 14 where Christ was, lot of research, lot of books. I have also read enough of books, but I am not able to say anything about this because we don't know anything. Everything is just assumption. Everything is just a theory. And I can say one or two interesting facts or one or two interesting things which I read in that book. The theory goes that Jesus had his training in Puri. In Puri there is a Buddhist monastery. He had his training there, and the Sermon on the Mount exactly is a translation of a Pali Sutra, which is repeated in that monastery every day morning as a prayer. Exactly verbatim, it's a translation of that prayer, that sutra, which is repeated in their monastery. And the original Pali is given, and the translation is given. Verbatim translation, the whole Sermon on the Mount. There are so many things, so many research reports are coming out. We don't know anything about it. I can be sure of one thing, in conscious level, both are one and the same. In a physical level, I don't know. Next. Please comment on desires. Most masters recommend sealing of desires. How can this be done? I can comment on desires, but I don't want to comment on most masters recommending. I can comment on the first part, commenting on desires, but I don't want to comment on this second statement, most masters recommend sealing of desires. How can this be done? I tell you honestly, sealing of desires can never be done. Suppression will lead only to perversion and other difficulties. You can do only one thing, transformation. Transformation is the only possibility. Suppression can never be done. Whether it is desire related to sense enjoyments or name and fame or anything, the more you suppress, more you will poison your system. The more you suppress, more they go deep into your system. All you can do is only one thing, transforming. Transforming the desires. If you want the transformation, enter into meditation. Let your energies be transformed. Except transformation, there is no other way to escape from desires. Just divert the energy. Let it become pure energy. When you transform, you will have the pure desire without directed towards any object. Desire without object is energy. When your energy is attached to some object, it becomes desire. When your desire is detached from object, it becomes energy. That is why in Vedic system we call desire as a Ichha Shakti. Desire energy. As long as there is no object, it leads you to bliss. When there is object, it leads you to bondage. You can only transform or purify it through meditation. You can never suppress. Suppression will lead only to more and more problem, more and more troubles and problems. A small story. Very old monk. 80 years old monk, senior monk, was interviewed by a junior brahmachari, novice, junior monk. The junior monk is asking the senior elder monk, "Master, how to control the bad thoughts? How long these bad thoughts continue to come in the mind?" The senior monk says, "I don't know how long it will continue to come. One thing I know, till 80 years they come." So please be very clear. Suppression will lead to nowhere. Only the transformation can help you. Work for transformation, not for suppression. Another one question. How will guru help disciple? What is the process? I think the whole Gita is the answer for this question. The whole Gita is the process. It starts with the intellectual clarity, then gives the experience, takes him through the whole path and puts him in the same consciousness in which he is living. The whole Gita explains the process. If you listen to the whole Gita, you will be able to understand the whole process. The whole Gita is the answer for your question. Any other question?
Two questions, Swamiji. One is, should we stick to practice it a hour, or is it okay to ask any question from other?
You can ask anything, but if you ask in this itself, you will have some more deep tips to follow this. You see, I am not speaking more today, because if I start speaking more, you will forget everything, just as Arjuna did. It's not that I have covered complete second chapter. No, I have not covered complete second chapter, but I know how much a human mind can receive. If I just stop with few concepts, these ideas will be working on you. Continuously, they will be working on you. The transformation process will happen. If I load you more than this, you will throw everything in the dustbin. That is the reason I stopped. I stopped with this one concept. Understand this one. Let it work in your mind. Let you understand this one. And understanding any one concept completely is more than enough. And if you put any other question, no problem, I can answer. But you will be getting more ideas instead of understanding. Vivekananda says beautifully, instead of reading the whole library, just take 5 concepts and digest them, enough. That's the reason. I just took few slokas and gave you the gist of the whole chapter, so that this can work on you. I am not speaking just to show that I know. I am speaking just to show that you should know. I wanted you to experience the whole Gita. That's the reason I am giving part by part, step by step. Let this go into your being. Let this work on your being. Let this do the process. The next day we will take up the other concept, the next idea. That's the reason, step by step, I am trying to take you through that process. It is very easy to read all the slokas and just give the translation or commentary. It's only intellectual process. It will add little more knowledge into your head. Means little more head weight. More problem. More difficulty. That's the reason. I do not want to add any more knowledge. The problem with Indians is not that they don't know. They know too much. That is the problem. The main problem is we know too much. So, I am not here to add more words to your head. I am here to take you beyond the words. I wanted you to experience it. I wanted you to digest the whole Gita. That's the reason I am giving part by part. Only few slokas. Actually, the second chapter, more than 70 slokas. But I have spoken only on a few. Because more than this, if I share, it will be only load. It will not be digested. You can ask any question related to these two chapters.
One question I'll drop, one question I'll ask.
Yes.
The question I have is, from future to past, if you explain to us, the question has to do with astrologers and farmers.
We have astrologers and?
Farmers and astrologers.
Yes.
Or who tell us our past and future. So, some of them are correct, some of them are wrong. Does it have
all
to
right. do all right. Let me explain. The person who predicts your future, you see, if you are sitting here, can you see the past or the future clearly? You can't. If you are sitting here, you can see little more clearly, like India Doordarshan. And if you are sitting here, it will be like a private channels. Little more clearly. If you come here, it will be your personal PC. If you come here, it will be directly seen. When the TPS comes down, the person will be able to see more clearly the future and past. A person whose TPS is very low, he will be able to predict your future properly and clearly. The person whose TPS is high, he will not be able to predict clearly because his mind is continuously moving. This side to that side and this side to that side and this side to that side. He will not be able to predict properly. One thing, the person who has established himself with this Nitya Atman or eternal consciousness, not only he will be able to predict, he will be able to change. That is why they say, there is a beautiful sloka. Brahma, with all his difficulty, sweating with all the pain, he writes your life on your head. He writes by his hand on your head. Brahma's handwriting will be just erased by Guru's left leg. When he walks, he erases it. Man is established in that eternal consciousness can just erase what is there in the future or in the mind. I think it is time to end the session.
Thank you so much.
Let's pray to the ultimate existence, the divine consciousness, para Brahma Krishna, to give us all the experience of eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you.